So is everyone able to get the assignment? Who tried?
Nate mentioned to me that on the assignment there's some reference there to some notes by Klaus Mohmer, which are nowhere to be found. So I will find them for you and post them in addition to the notes that are here for class. All right. I'll do that this afternoon. All right. So we're talking about the theory of quantum trajectories, which is both practically important and fundamentally important. And to do so, we were reminding ourselves about some more general discussion of quantum measuring theory. Okay? So we're looking at a general paradigm whereby I can learn information about a quantum system. Let's say I measure a quantum system sort of indirectly. That is to say, I take my quantum system and I couple it to some other quantum system that I'm calling the meter or the probe. I'm probing the system with some other quantum system and then measuring or observing the probe, okay, or the meter. So in this kind of paradigm, we have a few important mathematical elements that we discussed. There's the Krauss operator, which is an operator on the system. So this is an operator on the system, right? Because we've done a partial matrix element over the quantum meter. Okay. And with that, we defined a few different things. So we can ask ourselves the general Born rule. I'm measuring my quantum system through this process, okay? And I want to know, what's the probability when I do this, I get the outcome mu, labeled by mu, okay? The answer is the Born rule. The Born rule tells me how to turn quantum states into probabilities of measurement outcomes. Okay, this measurement outcome is coming indirectly through this ancillary quantum system, but nonetheless, we're learning something about our system through this procedure. And we want to know, what's the probability I'm going to see outcome mu? The answer is, the probability is given by the trace. This is more generally, if the system were a mixed state, it would be rho for the system if this were a mixed state rather than a pure state, but whatever. Of these elements we call, these operators we call elements of a POVM. We're stuck with the stupid name POVM. It's an arcane term. It doesn't really mean what it used to. A positive operator valued measure. Whatever. That has to do with measure theory, you know, on integrals. When you have if you've ever learned about that, the measures here are operator valued. And they're positive. Therefore, they're positive operator valued measures. But whatever. Now they're just known as POVMs, and no one knows what it stands for anymore. So the POVM is a general kind part of the foundation of quantum mechanics. Any quantum measurement is describable by some POVM, okay? So, and what defines a POVM is that it's a resolution of the identity into positive operators, or more precisely, non-negative operators, okay? So this is more general than the projection, kind of projective measurements that we're used to thinking about when we imagine a Hermitian observable that has eigenvectors, and then we would have a project, this would be a projector onto the eigenvalue, and this would then be the square of the probability amplitude. This is a more general concept than that. That's just this. So, for example, just something to, let's just back up for a moment. Suppose I have a spin 1/2 particle, and I wanted to measure it somehow. Can I perform a measurement where I have three possible outcomes? Usually when you measure a spin 1/2, you say, well, it's either spin up or spin down along some direction, right? I measure it along x, y, z, or any direction, I'll have two outcomes. But I claim I can have any number of outcomes. In fact, I can have a continuum of possible outcomes. How would I do that? Let's just do a little aside over here. I have my two-level system, my qubit. I entangle it with a Q-trick, which has three outcomes. And now I entangle this with this, and I measure whether I'm in 0, 1, or 2. And I'll get something. I'll get one of those outcomes. Now, those measurements are not projective measurements. Okay? It's not something we typically think of. You don't learn about this in quantum mechanics. I didn't teach you guys this, and I studied quantum mechanics this week. You don't have time to do everything. We wish we had time. We're doing it now. So this is just a little aside here. When you measure I can have a meter which has a continuum of outcomes, can measure a current on a photocurrent, and that's telling me something about an atom, say, that was coupled to a laser beam. So the number of outcomes mu here is not the dimension of the Hilbert space, necessarily, of the quantum system. It's the dimension of the meter, which can be whatever I like. Keep that in mind. All right, so that tells me the probabilities, and then the other thing I need from measurement theory is, given that I saw this outcome on the meter, how should I update the state of the system conditioned on a particular mu? Okay, so when we know we have a projective measurement, say corresponding to an eigenvector of, or measuring an observable A that has eigenvalues and eigenvectors, if I learn that eigenvalue and it's non-degenerate, the post-measurement state projects onto the eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue, right? That's the post-measurement state. That's the collapse of the wave function. This is the generalization of that for general kind of measurement of this flavor, okay? And what I do is I act the state not with necessarily a projector, but with the Krauss operator, not the PLVM element, the Krauss operator, and then I renormalize it, okay? Now, if I don't know the measurement model, I'm just giving a PLVM, I don't really know how to do the update rule. You need a measurement model. Otherwise, there's no thing that tells you what the update rule is. Yes, please.
I guess I'm not sure which operator to think about, like either the
POVM elements or the Krauss.
The Krauss, but can you think of it as like projecting it onto like a subset of the eigenstates of?
Well, I mean, of course, it is always, in some sense, has some support over some set of eigenvectors, as we were discussing, and we'll revisit this in a few lectures. Let's say that I had a spin J, which has some projections. These are the eigenvalues, say, of JZ. Okay? And so suppose my initial state had some, was, say, spin along X. Suppose I had the state J and X equals J. So it's maximum projection along the X direction. Okay? This would have a mean JZ of 0. Okay? And if J is sufficiently big, then you can show that the distribution, not that this is important, but it's just nice to kind of draw it, is something that becomes close to a Gaussian distribution. So made a histogram. This sort of approaches a Gaussian distribution of possible m's. Okay? Now, for a projective measurement, I would pick out one of these m values, right? In that case, my Krauss operator would be some to the degree that I approximate this as a continuous thing. I mean, it would be some really something more like a. It depends what mu lives in the continuous space or not. And that would pick out, that would be a projector that for a particular mu would pick out this value of mu when m equals mu, and it would be a projector onto that. Okay. But I can have a more general case. So this would be the case of a projective measurement. And if I expand this, well, this operator is, and that doesn't make sense, because I have to put it as an operator, right? This would be sum over m right, so that's the operator. This is a delta function. And this, to the degree that this is the projector onto that view. Okay, so this is a project. So this is the case, in this case, my Krauss operator is a projector. Okay? Suppose I have a more general thing. Okay? This operator is equal to I should make this, this should be a fourth, and this should be the fourth root. Because I want this to be an amplitude rather than, because n that are m's have to sum to one, not the m's themselves. Okay, so other, what I really would do is the field hidden elements. Okay. So this operator is not a projective measurement, but you see, as you say, it's kind of a subset of the M's. It's not quite, because it has this. So what this corresponds to would be some Gaussian that picks out this set of m's with a width that's of order sigma, right? So the post-measurement state, if I took this state, suppose my initial state of the system was some superposition state. Okay, so this is some superposition of m's. What is the measurement, the state of the system conditioned on this? The rule is over there. What do I do? I take this and multiply it by the Krauss operator, and then renormalize. So that would be the sum over n, cn, e to the minus m minus mu squared over 4 sigma squared with some normalization. And then I have to renormalize the whole thing. So I forget about that. Now what did that do? If this, as delta goes to 0, this would be like a delta function that would pick out the particular value mu. But this is like a fuzzy measurement, a measurement that doesn't have infinitely perfect resolution. It has a finite resolution. It can't, the meter itself can't perfectly distinguish between the different m values. So given that it has a finite resolution, the post measurement state would be the multiplying this Gaussian times this Gaussian, which would be another Gaussian that would be centered somewhere. You know, just, so now I'd have the post measurement state would look like that, centered, you know, somewhere close between mu and zero. If I multiply one Gaussian by another Gaussian, I get another Gaussian whose center is shifted a little bit and whose width is the adding the widths as if your resistors in parallel. You can check that. You know, 1 over sigma squared plus 1 over sigma b squared is 1 over sigma final squared. It's like adding resistors in parallel is how you multiply Gaussians together. It's a little dumb. So that's, you see what I'm saying? So this is a non-projective measurement. And if the resolution were terrible, I mean, I would be in a low back action regime. I would not learn very much, but I would also not disturb the system very much. Okay. There's always an information gain disturbance trade-off. Yes, sir.
In the case that you just described, can you explain why you wouldn't disturb?
So if I had my resolution of my detector was like that, well then it's multiplying it, it's like multiplying it by a constant, right? And then renormalizing it wouldn't change it. Because I basically my detector is too noisy to see the different projections. The quantum projections M, I can't resolve them. My detector has noise in it. That detector noise is related to the fact that this, I'm measuring something that's not an eigenstate of whatever observable has mu. So there's quantum noise in the meter, which is burying the different projection. I can't see it. All right. So this is the background of measurement theory that we then have been using. Strange, how is this thing? Anyway. To think about open quantum system dynamics. Okay. So, in our open quantum system dynamics, what we had was the system and the quantum environment. Okay? And we can think about this now as the environment is like the quantum meter. Which is monitoring the state of the system. Okay? Now, when we then asked about the open quantum system dynamics of this based on some map, we obtained that by tracing over the environment of entangling interaction between this environment, right? And this we wrote in terms of this Krafft decomposition, where this is the system, right? State. Now, what we, if we rewrite this, let's say that rho n, just for simplicity, is a pure state, then this is equal to sum over mu, mu, and from what we just saw over here, I can think about this as a statistical mixture of pure states, where sine mu is the post-measurement state associated with measurement outcome mu, and p mu is that, right? Which is the same thing as that, right? So the important point here is that we can, one way to understand or simulate, if we like, an open quantum system evolution is to say the environment has a record of the system, that's to say, is the environment, and when it comes entangled with the system, has information about the system. And if we observe or measure the environment, we'll get something, right? And if we do a projective measurement on the environment, we'll get some outcome mu with this probability. And conditioned on that measurement, the state of the system is updated to sine mu. So that would be if we kept the measurement record, but tracing over the environment is equivalent to not keeping that measurement record, throwing it away. So if we throw away the measurement record, that's like Alice prepared the system in some way, but didn't tell us what preparation she made. And when she doesn't tell us, what we have to do to update the system is to say, well, we're not sure which pure state she prepared. We know, or one way of expressing it is to say she prepared one of these states sine mu, and we know the probability with which she prepared it, which is given that. So she is the environment, okay? The environment, in some sense, we can think about it as the environment prepared one of these states, but didn't tell us what the result is. If we measured the environment and saw exactly what state of the environment was, we would post based on that, you know, through the EPR-like back action, get something onto the state. But since we're not keeping that measurement result, we average over all measurement results weighted by the appropriate probability. Rick, you had a question?
You just mentioned it.
Okay, right. Yes, Babette, you have a question.
Still thinking.
Okay, good. Think away. All right, so that's the key idea that an open quantum system dynamic can be thought of as there's some record in the environment of the system, And if we looked at that, if we measured what that record is, we would have a pure state, but since we don't, we average over the possible pure states consistent with that measurement, weighted by that probability distribution. Yes?
So last time when we were talking about the quantum medium, we said the collapse only happens when the measurement occurs, right? So here, even if the environment has the record, the collapse can only happen if someone looks at it and no one is looking at it. That's the part that's confusing me.
Yes. So that I think that is confusing. I mean, to the degree to which we don't look at this, then the whole state of the system is in a entangled pure state, which is that, right? That's a system environment entangled state. And it doesn't tell me a particular decomposition into mu, okay? However, since we're not looking at the environment, we trace over the environment, then there is a there is a deterministic output state, rho, which is this one. But that deterministic output state has an ensemble decomposition, which we can interpret as if we were to measure the environment, if we were to do that, we would, and measure it with some observables whose outcomes are these mu's, that is looking at the environment, these are environmental states, then we would get one of these outcomes mu with this probability, and if we found that, then the post-measurement state was that. And this gives us the same density matrix. So we can get, so one, another way to say that, and this is important for where we're heading with theory of quantum trajectories, is that we can simulate this map by doing this entangling unitary and then measuring the environment. We're going to get some outcome with some probability. So we would say, based on that, the first one, we got, you know, psi 1. And then we did it again, and we get psi 1 again. And then we do it again, and we get psi 2. And then we get, do it again, and we get psi 3. And then we do it again, and we do psi 3, depending on all the possible outcomes. And we divide by the total number of times we do that. And if we do this with the probability distribution that's generated by this, then this guy, which is the sequence of a series of measurements on the environment, is equivalent to tracing out the environment. Because I will get these outcomes with a frequency of occurrence which converges to the probabilities if I'm sampling from the right probability distribution. So it's a Monte Carlo simulation of this open quantum system through a series of pure states. All right, that's the key idea. And what we're gonna now, what we're doing now is seeing how this applies to the differential map of an open quantum system associated with the generator of open quantum systems in the Markov approximation. That is to say, the Lindblad master equation. So we're doing exactly this. Now, what we want to do is think about this input-output map as the differential map in time in an open quantum system dynamic. So in the Lindblad master equation, one way of writing that was to say we had a differential map which took the state of the system at time t to time plus dt. And that is given by a Krauss map. Where we separated out two kinds of Krauss operators. Where one of them, this is mu equals 1 to some number n, doesn't really matter, mu max, whatever that number is. So this is an example of an open quantum system map. And what we found was that this guy was the near identity map, right? Approximately even for to keeping order to only order dt, it's the same thing as that. So it's like a Schrodinger-like evolution. And mu, for mu greater than 0, was L mu square root of dt. And H effective has a Hermitian part, which we call the Hamiltonian, and an anti-Hermitian part, which depends on L mu's. And the L mu's are the Lindblad operators, or for reasons that will now become clear, they're often called the jump operators. Okay. So this is an example of what we were just talking about, but now with a differential map, this particular differential map. Okay. So now we have a way of simulating the dynamics in exactly the manner that I just described. Okay. So let's say that at time t equals 0, I start in a pure state. I don't have to, we'll explain in a moment what if we started in a mixed state, but let's just, for simplicity and for clarity, say that at time t equals 0, we start in a pure state, okay? So let's say at t equals 0, rho 0 is this, okay? So at a time dt later, my state is equal to what? Well, there it is, right? But I can write that in the following way. I can write that as dp0, psi 0, at dt, plus dp mu, sum over mu, equals 1 to mu max, dp mu, psi mu, dt. So just as I wrote on the board thing that I just erased, because I'm the best blackboard user in the world, the state at a later time is a mixed state. It's a statistical mixture of pure states weighted by certain probabilities. So now I ask you, what are these different things? First of all, what is dp mu? What do you think?
just when you do psi in.
So remember what this was, right? We have over here, dp nu was equal to the probability, it's the thing with the POVM element, right? Associated with, that's the Born rule. This is the POVM element. Or said another way, as we often write this, it's the square of the norm of this vector. All right? Which is what? Well, we have L mu over there. So this is equal to L mu dagger L mu BT. Right? Because that's the Krauss operator associated with that outcome. So with that, in that time interval dt, this is the probability of seeing outcome u corresponding to whatever that means. We'll think about that, some measurement on the environment which has that outcome. And that happens with this probability in that time interval. And given that we found that, this, what's the post-measurement state?
L mu square root of dt acting on the initial state.
Divided by
the norm.
The norm. And since this cancels out, we get rid of it. Okay? So, if we see outcome u, then the post-measurement state is the jump operator, a quantum jump occurs, which at in that differential time transforms the state to this state. Okay? And that happens with this probability. With probability dp0, which is equal to this with m0, which we often write this way, the post-measurement state is that? So that gives us the state. This would be the mixed state associated with not keeping the measurement record. Okay? Tracing over the environment. We trace over the environment, we get that.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, maybe I'm wrong, but isn't the right-hand side a differential in that sense that dp mu or dp u is dt, but on the left-hand side we have rho at dt?
Yeah, well, that's because we only evolve for a time dt.
Yeah, so shouldn't that be rho of dt minus...
Minus what?
Rho of zero.
No. No, this is not... This is that part of it. I mean, let's remember. Let's come back to this. This is not rho of t plus dt minus rho of t. This is the whole thing. The one comes from this. So let's just do that. Let's plug this in. I get rho of t minus I h bar h effective rho minus rho h effective dagger dt. So that's just plugging this in and keeping terms of order dt, right? And then I have plus sum over mu, L mu dagger, or L mu rho, L mu dagger dt, right? So now I can subtract this from the other side of the equation and divide by dt, and I get d rho dt is equal to minus I over h bar, h effective commuted with rho with a prime on it, and the prime means take the dagger, plus sum over mu rho L mu dagger, which is the Lindblad master equation. So this is not the differential rho, this is the rho at the later time. But thank you very much for that clarification, very helpful.
Yes, sir.
So when we say quantum jump, it doesn't necessarily mean like a jump from like an eigenstate to another eigenstate. It's like just a different state of the system.
It's just a different state of the system.
And the difference, like the number of different states it can jump to, is that dependent on the environment?
It does. Okay. And it's determined by whatever our mu is.
Okay.
So whatever this is, when the jump happens, the post-measurement state is obtained by operating the jump operator, or the Lindblad operator, onto the state, and then denormalizing it. And that's the state. Now, this might be going from one eigenstate to another, but it doesn't have to be.
Okay. And there's no jump operator associated with mu equal to zero, because that's just like a normal evolution of the system?
Yeah, well, we're going to get into, it's very important, the physics of this. We're going to get into that. As you say, Adrian, and that's an important thing you notice, this looks more like Schrodinger-like evolution, right? I mean, it's got this imaginary part to the Hamiltonian, but it looks like what we would get for the time evolution operators. This is what we call kind of like deterministic in some sense. And you may remember, at least you should, that in the early days when we started to talk about coherence and open quantum systems back last year in Quantum Optics 1, and I told you, and you can watch the video because I remember I said, keep this in mind because we're going to return to this, that if I don't have to include the feeding terms, you remember this is what we call the feeding terms in the master equation, and this was kind of the decay terms, I could treat that by just a non-Hermitian Hamiltonian, just put an imaginary part into the excited states, and I don't have to write a master equation, I can have just a Schrodinger-like deterministic evolution, but with an imaginary part to the Hamiltonian. But if the feeding terms are important, I can't do that. But what we're just about to learn is that I can do that is if I allow the evolution no longer to be deterministic, but to be stochastic. So that it either does this or this with some probability. And if I then average over that with the right statistics, I get the master equation. Right, okay, so what, we see now is what's known as a Monte Carlo wave function algorithm for simulating the master equation. How would that algorithm work? So let's, again, let's suppose at t equals 0, the state is pure. We'll come back in a moment to the case where it's not. But let's, just for simplicity, start with that case, okay? So, what we want to do is simulate this evolution, which makes this statistical mixture with these probabilities. What that means is just to run the experiment many times, the numerical experiment, many times, to see which of those measurement outcomes happens, and the frequency with which they happen, if you do it enough times and you're sampling from the right probability distribution, gives you those probabilities. So here is the algorithm. You start with, so what we do is we simulate what's known as a quantum trajectory. And a quantum trajectory is the stochastic evolution of the pure state condition on continuous measurement. Okay? So, again, we have our system, we have our environment, they're unitarily entangled, and we are constantly observing this, and through that, learning about the system. Okay? Yes?
So over here, it kind of seems that all the quantum jumps occur because the measurement's occurring, and it seems like all measurements are occurring at the same time. Is that why we're calling it continuous measurement?
No, it's continuous because it's in continuous time.
Okay.
Continuous means continuous time, which means that every time interval, we're doing a measurement.
Okay.
That's what we mean. So it's not measured, we're not, as a function of time, the measurement is happening. And every differential dt, there is some small observation that's being made. And then the next dt, we make another observation. And we do that in a differential sense of calculus that becomes a continuum of times.
Okay.
Okay? So we're gonna, in the way you numerically integrate a time evolution, you make a little Euler integral delta t.
And over here, it seems like just a lot of measurements are occurring, though, because the state's kind of collapsing. You're jumping to different possible.
Let's see how it works.
Okay.
Let's see how it works. So let's just, to start, let's just suppose this, and suppose this. We have one jump operator. We'll come back to the case of multiple jump operators L. I'm just going to have one of them. We'll come back to the case where I have them labeled by mu, where mu could be up to mu max, however big mu max is. Let's just say mu max is 1 in this case. All right? All right, so what do we do? Step 1. So we want to get psi at 0 goes to psi at dt. Okay, that's the first step. We want to update the state by 1, and let's call it a delta t because we're going to do it on a computer, so it's a small number. Okay, well, let's think. Delta t has to be sufficiently small compared to whatever time scale over which the state evolves. Like when you're doing, you're doing an Euler integration, you want to make sure your dt's are sufficiently small. So this should be much, much smaller than, you know, any decay times or frequencies of evolution, or 1 over the frequencies. right? Whatever time scales determine, they're in the age effective. The time scales associated with age effective. So we want those times. We want this time delta to be tiny compared to that. Okay? So how am I going to determine what this is? There I do it, right? So what I do is, the first thing I have to ask myself is, jump, no jump. How am I going to do that?
Do you compare the probability?
Right, so I have to simulate. What I know is the probability of there being a jump, we'll call that P, or I'll call it P jump, which is the DP mu in this case. Which is, what is that? What's that probability? It's right there. It's equal to, I calculate that, well, there's only one L, T, or delta T. Okay? So the first thing I do is I calculate what is the probability for there to be a jump in this first little delta T. So now how do I simulate whether a jump happens? Monte Carlo, how do I do Monte Carlo? I want to, on a computer, make the event happen with this probability. How do I do that on a computer? So this is a number between 0 and 1, right?
Make a distribution of a sample.
That's right. So what's distribution? What I would do is I would say, I would make this, here's 0, here's 1. And I would pick a random number. Epsilon, which is between 0 and 1. I think it's the function RAND on some MATLAB or Mathematica, right? Picks a random number between 0 and 1. Here it is. Okay? Now, this number is going to actually be pretty darn small if delta t is small. So it's going to be somewhere down here, right? And then what do? To determine whether or not.
You would condition whether.
So I've calculated this, and I've, on my computer, thrown a random number. I've produced this. How do I decide whether the jump happens or not?
Could you say, like, if DP is greater than epsilon, then it jumps, and if it's less.
The other way around.
The other way around.
So if DP. So this fraction of 1 is dp.
Okay.
So if dp is less than or equal to epsilon, jump. Else, don't jump. Okay? So that's the first thing. I decided whether a quantum jump happened or not in this time interval. Okay. If a jump happens, what do I do?
You update.
Sorry?
You update the system and you update your state.
I have to update the state conditioned on the information I got. So my psi at 0 goes to psi at dt, which is one of two things. If it's a jump, then I apply the jump operator to the state and renormalize. If it's no jump, which happens with a probability 1 minus that, what do I do?
Effective Hamiltonian too.
Exactly. So I update it
you know, with a little, I could write it as 1 plus this, because this is a small dt, right? Divided by the norm of that, right? This is dt, sorry. Or delta t. Okay, so now I've done the first step. And now what?
Do it again.
I do it again. So now, depending on where I am in this branch, either this happened or this, but this is equal to this, and then I ask the same question. Jump, no jump. And in this next interval, this could jump or no jump. And this keeps branching, each delta t. And I do this for as many time intervals as I want until my final time, which is some number of delta t's to get to the final time that I need. Yes, sir?
It kind of seems that the jump is conditioned on how big delta t is.
It is.
So if delta t goes to really, really small, it's not going to be a jump.
It's extremely unlikely. But it's going to happen eventually, okay, because it has the right statistics. And of course, to truly, truly simulate this in this algorithm, you need delta t to go to zero, right? Otherwise, it's not. But of course, then you'd have an uncountably infinite number of opportunities to see a jump, right? It would eventually happen, but whatever delta t is, but you're right, most of the time, you're not gonna see a jump. We'll come back to that, it's a very important point.
Yeah, but whenever that delta t is really small, according to that inequality, every random number that you pick says jump. So shouldn't that be other way around?
That's a good point.
Or even if dp is 1,
yeah,
you no. always have to.
Yeah, no, no, it's the wrong way.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's the fraction, yeah. Sorry. Thank you for noting that. So, what we see here is a stochastic evolution of possible histories of this pure state. You know, it could do this, or it could do that, all the different possible histories of pure state evolution. So there are different possible stochastic histories of the pure state evolution. Okay. Each one of them is called a quantum trajectory, each one of these things. And this kind of history is known as all the histories together. So the collection of possible histories is called an unraveling of the master equation. We've kind of unraveled in time in terms of histories of possible ways quantum jumps could have happened in the system, when it might have happened or not. I'll talk about a physical example of this in just a moment. This is known as an unraveling of the master equation. This is a term that Howard Carmichael coined. And now, thus, what we see is that the density matrix that we would get would be the ensemble average of possible stochastic trajectories. And since we have simulated, with our Monte Carlo algorithm, whether a jump happened or not, that was consistent with the Krauss operators, Limbaugh operators, we get the right weighting. This, what I mean by this, is that I sum over, so let me label by alpha, a particular run of my computer program. So I run my computer program, and I get some size, a function of t, according to this algorithm.
So each alpha is a different trajectory?
Is a different trajectory, a different quantum trajectory. And I don't know, and then I run the computer program again. And I look at I then sum together all those pure states, and I average over the total number of times that I ran the computer. And this, as number goes to infinity, converges to the density matrix. Because the frequencies of outcomes converge to the probabilities under the law of large numbers, if you're sampling correctly with the less than on the right side of the equation. Okay. Yes?
So, and this probably, I think what you just said probably just does answer it, but when we're doing the Monte Carlo simulation, you start with a pure state, and it evolves into another pure state, right? Even though our density matrix is a mixed state. And so the thing, and then my confusion probably is answered from that because, but I still want to ask it, which is d rho over dt has both terms. It has the effective Hamiltonian term. It also has the jump term. But here we're only choosing to do one net each time.
That's right. And they happen with some probability. So this is equivalent. Any one of these quantum trajectories corresponds to not tracing over the environment, but measuring the environment. And because the environment and the system are entangled through the EPR-like spooky action at a distance, the system gets updated. And since I lost no information, the system remains in a pure state. It may not be a projection, but it's still pure. At the next state, it becomes, and it's always staying a pure state. It's important to remember that even when we don't have a jump, the evolution is not unitary. It still has this imaginary part. We'll come to that right now. A quantum trajectory here corresponds to a situation in which you are retrieving all the information by doing a full measurement on the environment. And because the environment and the system are entangled, you get back action on the system. The density matrix evolution corresponds to throwing away that measurement record and pretending you didn't have it, which is equivalent to averaging over all possible histories that could have happened. Okay, so we simulate that by running lots of histories. We would need an infinite number of that for to really converge exactly to the density matrix. And what you're going to see so let's talk about a specific example now to be clearer. Oh, I should say, let's suppose two different things. Firstly, suppose my state is some mixed state. How would I do this simulation? What do you think? Matt likes to answer in sign language.
You just do it with each individual pure state and then like average.
Exactly. So this is an ensemble average of different pure states. We would do a quantum trajectory for each psi j in the statistical mixture and then just average it. So. Okay, that clear? Right, so that's
Another case, suppose we have lots of different possible jump operators, more than one at least. How would we do this Monte Carlo simulation then? Well, again, I have a jump or no jump, but I have to ask which jump, right? So a particular jump happens with this probability. And the total then would be the sum over them. So first I would ask jump or no jump by calculating each one of these guys and summing them up and then doing the same thing. And if a jump happens, so I go back into my sort of pseudo flow chart here, I'd have to ask which jump happened, right? So I would have some possible jumps, mu1, mu2, mu3, whatever they are. So this is jump. And depending upon this, each one of these happens with some probability dp mu, I apply the particular. So how do I decide which one of them occurred? Well, I have to simulate dp, the fraction, right? So dp mu over dp is the fraction of times mu happens, right? Because the sum of all of them give me. So this is some other random number, eta. And I do the same Monte Carlo trick to see which one. So I have to roll another dice in the computer to determine. And this is the fraction of times that particular guy happens. Yeah.
Shall not we include jump in this manner as well? Because if you add up all the different jumps versus no jump, usually the other probabilities would be large, then no jump always turns out to be really small compared to that. So maybe jump should be...
Oh no. All of these summed together are small. Because they're all proportional to dt.
That is true.
So it doesn't matter.
Okay.
Yeah. So you would just first check, is there a jump or is there not? Most of the time there's not, if the delta t is small. And then you would determine which of the jumps happened by rolling another dice in the computer, getting a random number between 0 and 1, and seeing whether or not it falls below eta. Okay, this eta is. All right, good. So, let's talk about the physics of this now. Let's look at... specific example. Let's look at the simplest possible problem. Let's look at the decay of a two-level atom. Okay? So, our master equation is our familiar one. I've set the free evolution, I've taken it out. Right? Of the atom. This is just the decay part. Right? So here, H effective is H bar gamma over 2 sigma plus, or minus I, sigma plus, sigma minus, right? So that's equal to minus I H bar gamma over 2. The excitant state has imaginary part to it, as we said. And we typically also have an excited state energy here, but I'm in the interaction picture, I'm just taking out the free evolution of the system. Clear? What is my Lindblad jump operator? Sigma, I mean, so sigma, there's one jump operator and it's the square root of gamma sigma minus. That's the thing. And this, of course, is equal to minus I h bar over 2, L dagger L is what we expect. So we say what's the effective Hamiltonian. Right? All right. Now, this is a problem that if without any evolution, I mean, we can solve this exactly. Imagine quake. We don't need Monte Carlo to do this, but it's just sort of useful for our understanding of the problem. You know, what we would see here is that, you know, the excited state as a function of time would just, this population would just decay, right, in this problem. So this is a matrix element. The coherences would also decay, and they would decay with that rate. That's the solution of this. And the ground state at time t is 1 minus the excited state at time t. So that's what we expect the solution to be. But what would we see if we simulated a quantum trajectory in this system? Well, first of all, so let's say at time t equals 0, let's say we have some pure state, which is some superposition of ground excited. So now I do my Monte Carlo simulation on the system. Let's say, so now let's look at a time delta t later. First of all, what's the probability to see a jump in this time interval?
It's the initial state, I guess the Lindblad operator.
Yeah.
Acting on the initial state, taking them wrong.
Yeah. So this is equal to L acting on the initial state square dt, right? Which is what? So L is sigma minus. So this is gamma sigma minus acting on CG, CE squared.
CE squared,
right? So this is equal to gamma. So it's CE squared times gamma dt. Is that what you would have guessed? You better be, because this is saying that there's some probability to be in the excited state at time t equals zero. And if it's in the excited state, it could decay. And this is the probability of it decaying, which is dt times the rate of decay. Right? So this is what we would expect in a time dt. And so most of the time, our delta t, this is going to be much, much smaller than 1. But if it does, if the jump happens, which could, then what is the post-measurement state? So I apply this, I apply L to the state, and then renormalize.
It's
going to be what? The ground state, which is what you expect. So if a jump happens, so we start the system in some superposition. Let's say, for example, it was a 50-50 superposition of ground and excited. There's some possibility of a jump happening. A jump, in this case, corresponds to spontaneous emission of the atom. That happens only if the atom was in the excited state. There's some probability that it's in the excited state. There's some rate at which decay happens. And this small dt, it could spontaneously emit. And if spontaneous emission happens, after that, the state is in the ground state. Okay? Now, let's suppose the jump happened. What would be the next step? We would ask jump, no jump, right? Can there be a jump ever again? No, because now it's in the ground state and it stays there. Okay? Jump happened. And there's no laser to re-excite it up to the excited state. We'll come back to that. But let's conclude this extra 12 minutes of lecture by saying, what happens when we don't have a jump in the time dt? Well, H effective here is equal to H bar gamma over 2 times minus I, right? So this is equal to what? Well, I'm going to get CG0 plus CE times 1 minus I gamma over 2.
No I, right?
Sorry?
Do we have
minus
I? Yeah.
Sorry. Right. Times Using me.
Let me just confuse myself about one thing here. And this, and oh yeah, okay, no, that's sorry. Over the norm of this, right? And the norm of this is the square root of CG0 squared plus CE0 squared plus the square of that, which the first order is that, right? You square it, the dt squared curves are differentially small. So now, I can write this as square root, this guy is 1 minus CE0 squared, which of course what I expect, this is dp0, 1 minus the probability of a jump, 1 minus the probability jump is the probability of no jump, which is what we get. And if this is small, I'm putting it into the numerator with the binomial expansion, and I get very important. Notice what happens here. I'm just giving the sign language. We're all learning that sign language in the back there, excuse me. But let's notice what happens. Firstly, this evolution is nonlinear, right? It happened through this renormalization step. It's not a linear map, it's a nonlinear map. One thing to keep in mind. Secondly, notice what happened. At the later time, CG at a time delta t, the magnitude of this is now bigger than what it was initially. And the this guy, the probability amplitude in the excited state, its magnitude is now smaller than it was at the initial time. Why? Nothing happened. We didn't have a jump. No photon was emitted. So this is like a Gedanken experiment in which we imagine we have 4 pi steradians of photodetectors constantly ready in Geiger mode to click when they see a photon. They're waiting there. And in this time interval, there was nothing, we saw nothing. Nonetheless, the state updated in this manner. How do you interpret that?
Is it the interaction with the vacuum?
Well, it clearly, if we didn't have the interaction, we wouldn't have had this, so it's arriving there. But why is it makes sense that a null result updates the state? And why would not seeing a photon mean we increase the probability amplitude to be in the ground state and decrease the probability amplitude to be in the excited state?
You didn't see a photon, and it's more likely to be in the ground state.
Exactly. We're looking at this thing, and we're asking it, are you in the excited state, or are you in the ground state? If I'm in the excited state, there's a chance I'll see a photon. And if I do, that's a lot of information. Then it was definitely in the excited state. And that's a whole lot of information, and we have a huge change in the state. It goes to ground, because we learn for sure But if we don't see a photon, well, we don't know for sure. But it's slightly more likely that it was in the ground state. Because if it were in the excited state, it would have given us a photon. So it rotates in this nonlinear way towards the ground state, Lipschitz in this case, because we didn't see a photon. It's not a projecting, because we're not for sure now, right? It could have still been in the excited state. But the fact that we didn't see a photon is information too. And that's important to make this whole thing be self-consistent, as we shall see next week. All right? Lots of fun. This is a fun topic.
All right.
I will post the Fagel-Mulmer notes. See you guys soon.